Image copyright U.S. Navy. Image caption: the USS Carl Vinson, seen here in a file image, is one of the U.S. naval supercarriers. The immense nuclear-powered U.S. aircraft carrier Carl Vinson has powered into Vietnamese waters, the first such visit since the end of the Vietnam War. The BBC's Southeast Asia correspondent Jonathan Ted looks at how the rise of China lies behind this. The influence of the United States in Asia is much diminished these days, but it still has one spectacular card it can play. That comes in the form of the deployment of a carrier strike group, a naval flotilla centered on one of 11 giant supercarriers, floating nuclear-powered air bases more than 300 meters long, carrying enough air power to flatten a small city. The presence of a U.S. carrier group can send a message of deterrence, as in the case of North Korea, or of support. The USS Carl Vinson's arrival in Da Nang this week is a visible gesture of commitment by Washington to the country with which it fought a terrible war just two generations ago. An absence of recrimination. The U.S.-Vietnam rapprochement dates back to the restoration of diplomatic relations in 1995. Since then, there has been a steady improvement in ties through trade, cultural exchanges, diplomacy and military cooperation. Image copyright Getty Images. Image caption: China is one of a number of countries who lay claim to parts of the South China Sea. Disagreements over the harsh treatment of political and religious dissidents in Vietnam have not been allowed to interrupt this progression, and there is a remarkable absence of recriminations over the past. The fact that the USS Carl Vinson is docking just a few kilometers from the beach where U.S. combat troops first landed in Vietnam in 1965, and not far from some of the bloodiest battlefields of the war, presents a poignant historic backdrop to this visit, but in no way overshadows it. This is the culmination of a quiet, careful courtship. The rise of China is what drives it, for the Americans and for the Vietnamese. Despite the better-known history of the U.S.-Vietnam conflict, Vietnamese resentment of its giant neighbor goes back much further, embedded in the folk memory of a millennium of Chinese domination in ancient times. Vietnam shares a border more than 1,000 kilometers, 620 miles, long with China, through which more than $90 billion, 65 billion pounds, in trade passes, but which in 1979 was the scene of a short war in which thousands of troops died on both sides. Image caption: the relationship between Vietnam and China, foundered in the 1970s over relations with Cambodia's Chinese-backed Khmer Rouge regime. The two communist parties once enjoyed a fraternal camaraderie, as close as lips and teeth, they used to say. Then they fell out during the Sino-Soviet split in the mid-1970s, Vietnam choosing the Soviet Union as a patron, and over Vietnam's invasion of Cambodia in 1978 to oust the Chinese-backed Khmer Rouge regime. That adversarial relationship only changed after the collapse of the Soviet Union in the late 1980s forced Vietnam's communist leadership to rethink their position in the world and establish a foreign policy based, they said, on friendship regardless of ideological allegiances. At that time, they put a lot of diplomatic effort into rebuilding bridges with China. But their differences over the South China Sea remained a problem. Both countries claimed parts of the Paracel and Spratly Islands, and have on occasion fought over them. Keeping the U.S. engaged. Strong anti-Chinese sentiment lies just below the surface in Vietnam, and is easily stirred up. In 2014, protests over China's deployment of an oil rig into disputed waters set off violent protests in Vietnam targeting what they believed were Chinese-owned factories. It was against a backdrop of increasing Chinese assertiveness in the South China Sea after 2002 that Vietnam began reaching out to its former American foe. That was when China agreed to a declaration of conduct with the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, ASEAN, four of whose members claimed islands in the disputed waters, which was supposed to halt island grabs and construction on coral atolls. But that has not stopped China building air bases, missile bunkers and radar stations to fortify its hold on the islands. Image caption: firms with Chinese characters in their logos or signs were targeted in the protests in 2014. Distracted by wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, it was only in a landmark speech by Secretary of State Hillary Clinton at ASEAN in July 2010 that the U.S. expressed its interest in maintaining freedom of navigation in the South China Sea, and in having disputed adjudicated through international law. Following that speech, the Obama administration announced a pivot back to Southeast Asia. Moving closer to Vietnam was a core part of that. In 2016, during a state visit to Hanoi, President Barack Obama announced the lifting of all restrictions on sales of military equipment to Vietnam, ending the last legacy of the Vietnam War. Vietnam was also party to the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a proposed free trade group of 12 countries championed by President Obama as a way of projecting U.S. influence and values in a region where it had been losing ground to China. So the decision by President Donald Trump to abandon the TPP was a blow to Vietnam, a strong beneficiary from the deal. Undeterred, Prime Minister Win Son Phuc made sure he was the first Southeast Asian leader to visit President Trump in Washington in May last year, and then hosted him during the APEC summit in November. Keeping the U.S. engaged is still a priority for Vietnam, part of a sophisticated and subtle web of diplomatic initiatives aimed at making its friendships as close as they can be without antagonizing its all-important relationship with China. Image caption: President Obama in May 2016 announced that the Vietnam arms embargo would be lifted. The U.S. does not yet have a strategic partnership with Vietnam, but the U.S. military has been exploring new areas of cooperation with its Vietnamese counterparts. So far, these have largely been in non-traditional aspects of defense, like peacekeeping and disaster response. There has been no talk yet of the kinds of joint military exercises the U.S. conducts with allies like Japan, South Korea, and the Philippines, nor has Vietnam shown any interest yet in acquiring significant U.S. military hardware. Such a move might be viewed as a provocation by China, something the current communist leadership in Vietnam will choose to avoid. The presence of a U.S. aircraft carrier in Da Nang, one which will be conducting so-called freedom of navigation passages through the disputed areas of the South China Sea, also sends a potentially provocative message to China, but only a symbolic one. To date, U.S. expressions of concern over China's actions in the sea have had no discernible impact on the construction of military facilities there. The U.S. carrier strike group looks impressive, but it is not clear what it can actually do to restrain China. Even as Vietnam's top brass enjoying the might of the superpower they once fought, now paying court as a would-be ally, they must remain mindful of the continuing historic shift in the balance of power in their region away from the United States, in favor of China.